And nobody told me about French kissing. You know, that was something that...
That hadn't
nobody,
come up.
No, it hadn't come up.
Can greed ever be good?
David, if I tell you the number of investment bankers over the years that come up to me drunk at some restaurant saying, you know, you're the guy that got me into my business. Greed is good. You know, yeah. And I'm looking at it, I was the bad guy. You know, I was supposed to be the villain.
Because people were very envious reading that you'd gone into a clinic because of your sex addiction. Was that why you went in?
No, that was, I would like to have understood what sex addiction is.
Yeah, most people want to get it. What's the secret to looking presidential?
Having the right amount of shoulder padding. The shoulder pads are generally a little oversized, stick out, no soft sloping shoulders.
It's nice having people calling you Mr. President all day.
All day long.
For a few weeks.
Yeah, I got used to that, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I was a little impossible for a while when I came home.
Basic instinct. You've never done a sequel.
No, no, I took my pants off once is enough.
Was it love at first sight?
I had a drink, and later that evening, after a few celebrations, I did speak about, I want to father your children. I think her last line to me was something to the effect, well, you know, I've heard a lot about you, Michael, and I've seen a lot about you, and it's nice to know it's all true. Good night, you know. So I said, okay, that takes care of that.
Michael Douglas does not lend himself to quick and easy definition. Too often, the public tends to confuse the real Michael Douglas with the roles he plays in movies. Whether the philandering husband in Fatal Attraction, the morally confused detective in Basic Instinct, or the amoral tycoon in Wall Street. But there's no confusion about where Douglas stands today in Hollywood. How he got there in 25 years, starting as a schoolboy in short pants in Manhattan, is a journey that is a marvel to behold. He became bi-coastal before the term was popular, living on the East Coast with his mother and spending summers working for his father, Kirk, as a gopher or extra. Kirk Douglas cast a long shadow over Michael's career, but that started to change in 1976, when he won an Oscar as producer of the film One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. Now he had his own clear identity, no longer was he known simply as his father's son. In 1987, he won a second Oscar, this time as Best Actor for his role in Wall Street. In private life, his marriage to Deandra Luca ended in divorce after 19 years. But in 1998, a trip to the film festival in Deauville, France, turned into a trip to a new life for Douglas. It was there he met the beautiful, raven-haired, brown-eyed Welsh actress named Catherine Zeta-Jones. Their courtship was quick and to the point. They married in November 2000, and they have a baby boy named Dylan Michael Douglas. Whenever possible, they slip away to the Douglas estate on Mallorca, and that is where we caught up with Michael.
How long have you been here, Michael?
I've been here at Sestaca now almost 10 years, but I've been coming to Mallorca for about 20, about 20 years, yes. Deandra, my ex-wife, first introduced me to it, and so we used to come every summer, and I love it, particularly this side of the island. This is the North Shore, and everybody always thinks of Mallorca as being this, you know, this huge tourist haven, but this whole side of the island is really quiet, beautifully dramatic, and we love it.
It's got such a wonderful atmosphere, too. And are they vines in the distance over there?
Yeah, we grow our own grapes, make our own wine. I may twist your arm tonight, see what happens, but I'm really...
I'm interested.
It's actually turned out really well. We just consume it, do a very good job of it.
Excellent, excellent. Michael, with a wonderful setting like this, a new and happy marriage, a baby son, movies like Traffic, grossing more than 100 million and so on, your life must seem pretty good at the moment. Is it the happiest time of your life, do you think?
Oh, I would say so. I would say so. I think, you know, I sort of personally divide your life up into your career and your personal life, and sometimes we get satisfaction in our work and sometimes from our family or our loved ones. And for me, I can't think of any time when the balance has been so good.
Do you think you're going to be a different sort of father the second time compared to the first?
Yeah, I think 20 years, 22 years after Cameron, my first son, was born, again, I was in a different career position then. And I think that one is sort of very consumed with one's career earlier in one's life, and then when you achieve certain things, you're not. And so your patience is much better. You listen much better. And you just have a chance to enjoy it. You don't feel like you're overwhelmed. So I think I'll be much better second time around.
Well, let's go right back to the very beginning, September the 25th, 1944, which you probably don't remember too clearly, your mother wrote later, all through his babyhood, Michael never smiled or laughed much. People would waggle their ears, make ridiculous faces or rude noises. Occasionally would be rewarded with a ravishing grin, but mostly he contemplated the world with a serious and reflective mien. Was that you, do you think?
I think if she said it was, she has a better recognition than I do. I know recently my mother was over and she was visiting Dylan, our little baby, and he has this strange, whether he's gonna be a conductor or not, his hands are always going like that. And I said, you know, I'm actually a little worried about his, you know, thought maybe there's some problem. But she said, no, that was exactly like you were when you were a little child. You used to do that all the time. And the other amazing thing about genetics is I, a lot of times, put my thumb between my fingers, which I thought was some nervous gesture that I'd picked up. And then a couple of years ago, I noticed that Kirk also does it. And when Dylan was a day old, we looked down, Catherine and I looked down, and he had his thumb between his fingers.
That's incredible.
Bizarre little genetic twists.
You're Michael Douglas, but the family went through Danielovich was the original name, and then Dembski. Three stages to the name Douglas. That was because Kirk's coming from...
Right, Kirk, my family's, on my father's side is from Belarus, Russia at one time, now the country of Belarus. And they immigrated here in 1914 to the U.S. Kirk was born, Isur was his original name, was born in 1916. And quickly progressed and wanted to become an actor, worked his way through college, and then went to the American Academy of Dramatic Arts in New York after school. At the same time, my mother, who is Bermudian, was schooled in the Isle of Wight. She also had a dream about becoming an actress, and she also went to the American Academy of Dramatic Arts, and so they met at drama school in New York, and as a result, my brother Joel and I are here.
Yeah, a wartime marriage and so on.
It was. Actually, they met in school. Kirk went off into the Navy, was on a submarine chaser boat, went to school. My mother has some wonderful stories of seeing him off in San Diego, except they had a little worried because they couldn't get out of the harbor. Their captain couldn't get the boat out of the harbor, which made them a little nervous. And sure enough, about 4 months later, they were doing testing. They were doing depth charge tests for catching submarines, and they blew themselves up. They blew their boat up, and my father got some internal injuries and was... taken out of the Navy.
Oh gosh! So it was friendly fire.
Friendly fire is what it was.
Yeah, goodness. And then, your brother Joe was 2 to 3 years after you.
He's 2.5 years
after you. Yeah, and your mother said that when the baby came, you said no, mommy, but very soon you were very caring for him.
Yeah, I think siblings are always a little hard to accept at first, but being the first son. First children, they tend to assume a lot of responsibility, and I think I probably did my share.
Well, in fact, she said you were very responsible when you went to the beach, telling your mother off for letting young Joel go too close to the water and so on. But of course, the thing you very soon had, and she writes about the first signs of trouble in the marriage and how you'd have to sit there while they had rows and so on. That was a difficult time, presumably, although And now we're coming to a time when you probably remember it more clearly.
Well, sure. I mean, they got divorced when I was five. And whatever conflicts were going on, you know, before then. So I do think you probably learn to sort of stuff it. If I would say that'd be the English side, whereas my father was very Russian and kind of impassioned and all of that. And my mother tended to be more reserved and sort of stuffed it. But after the divorce, I moved to New York with my mother. I remember the first time Kirk coming to visit, and he came in and he gave her a kiss on the cheek. And I always remember breaking into tears because I think I was so concerned about the tension that was going to happen. And I'm very fortunate, and I've tried to share this with other divorced parents, in that as long as the parents get along in front of their children, you know, most things can be resolved. But it's only that ongoing bickering and animosity and tension that it spills over into the children's lives.
So it was a classic case of, as they always used to say back in the 60s and so on, of better two parents apart who are happy with one another than two parents who stay together
Yes, I think, absolutely. I think when Kirk went out to Hollywood and began his career and took off like a locomotive, and it's all-consuming, you know, for a lot of people. It's very hard to sort of balance your personal life, your family life with your career, and I think that really took over for him for many years.
And you went to school, well, you had four or five different homes within a relatively few years in the early days between New York and New Brunswick and L.A. and so on, didn't you? Mm-hmm. You had many different...
Well, we grew up in New York City. I went there for a few years. My mother was under contract for 1 year out to Hollywood. We went out there for a year. And then she came back and remarried a wonderful man, William Darrett, and we moved to Connecticut. And I basically grew up there. And that was a very sane, a very un-Hollywood kind of existence, and I think has probably been a big influence in keeping my life in order.
You had one, in terms of your mum being an actress and so on, you had a terrifying experience in September 1950, was it, when a nanny let you watch her live on television?
Well...
And she came home and you said, oh, thank God you're alive.
Well, I've had a couple of those, but we did. My mother did a live television show, and I remember it was an airplane crash, I believe, or something, and we kind of were a little caught up in the realities of what was happening. But it's a wonderful, as far as careers are, David, you know, theater and films, it was one of the few equal opportunities, roles for women.
And then your mother said she spotted you somewhere in the early 50s, limping down the hall. And you said, what are you doing? What are you doing, Michael? And you said, I was just trying to be that old man who lives downstairs. And she thought, oh boy, he's got the butt.
But I guess I did. It took a long time after that to express it or to really begin acting.
And you didn't plan it immediately. If you hadn't eventually ended up as an actor and a producer, what would have been second?
You know, I was such a late bloomer. I mean, you fantasize about being an athlete, but I don't think that was in the cards, a professional athlete. But I really didn't know. And I think because both my mother was an actress and my father, ultimately that's all I knew.
And you said once, much later, you said that, in fact, not many people who are second generation do manage to make it. It's quite difficult.
Well, as I look now in perspective, it's right. There are not many either sons of famous actors or musicians or daughters. Sometimes it works in opposite. I mean, if you're the daughter of a famous male man, but there's not many. And so I take some pride in that.
And then there was the time about 1955 when you had to go back to L.A. And you were saying early on that not being brought up solely in L.A. was a saving grace, probably. But you went, because of the schooling being good in New York, you went into a class of boys much older than you, and you fell among bad company, as they say, with Black leather jackets, Elvis pompadours, and...
I was basically 11 years old in a private, or what you call a public school, in New York City, wearing gray flannel shorts and knee socks and little beanie hats and blazers. And then I moved and I jumped into a junior high school, sort of at the height of like West Side Story, with we had the Pachucos and all of that. So I was 11 and they were all 13 and 14 years old. And I was trying to keep up. And of course, the girl that was full grown in our class thought I was the cute and sort of took a liking to me. So it was all a little much. And I think my mother always teased my mother the first time I went, because you know, movies is about the first place where parents allow kids to go alone. Mm. Going to a movie theater is the first place and first time. And I had this Amazon of a girlfriend. I was only, you know, however tall I was at 11 or 12 years old. She was 13, 14. I remember finally sort of creeping my arm around her, you know, and having read and getting over it, and went in for my first little kiss, and this girl had her mouth wide open, was like new at everything from Sunday, and nobody told me about French kissing. You know, that was something that...
That hadn't
nobody,
come up.
No, it hadn't come up. It hadn't come up. So, what's this?
Hadn't come up in biology.
No, it hadn't come up yet when 12-year-old.
Or in sports, even. And then, anyway, your mother clearly thought it was a bit much for you, the school and so on, and you landed up in one of the few schools you could move to in the middle of a year, which turned out to be a military school?
Went to a military academy in Los Angeles.
Black Fox?
Black Fox Military Institute.
That must have been awful, was it, or not?
It was a pretty strange adjustment from the high school. And I was in the band. I mean, I don't know. My only memory there was I was a trumpet player, but I was like the fifth trumpet player. And if they didn't have an even number of people for the in the marching for the company, the headquarters company, and the flag bearer, I was the backup flag bearer. And I do remember the one time the headquarters company, the band, led the whole regiment, which was the entire school, on a Fridays in these exercises. And sure enough, one day I was carrying the flag. And they used to have this exercise, go past Dan, they'd go, eyes! Right, and you'd spin the flag around like this, and you'd look, you know, right on down, and I've been working on it.
Yeah.
A nice flag, big golden eagle and all the things. So I was a lot shorter than the guy who usually did it, so I went, eyes, right, and I turned the thing around, and the eagle went right into the ground, right into the sod, I mean, just dug into the sod. It was right in front of the reviewing stands. I'll never forget it. They were all watching me like this. They're going, ba-da-da-da-da-da-da, they're marching on past. So I pull it up, I run up to the front of the headquarters, I'm so embarrassed, you know, I sort of pull myself together. I take a chance, I look up, and there's this poor eagle, his neck is all bent, he's got a big piece of sod, grass, you know, hanging out of his side, so that was my last time as the flag bearer.
And what's more, there were no tall, beautiful Amazons and no French kisses.
No, that was the beginning, close to the beginning of my all-boys schooling.
One-on-one with David Frost, Michael Douglas will return. We return to One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas.
And then you went back to Westport, Connecticut, and a good local school there.
Good local school for a couple of years. Had a wonderful, wonderful environment. Really enjoyed it a lot before I went away to boarding school.
And you and Joe built a treehouse, but then it was discovered it wasn't your tree. Is that right?
Boy, David, you really, this is your life. You have done your research. This is true. We were very excited, and my mother and my stepfather were very happy that we were as young, productive, healthy kids outside living in the country were doing something constructive, except it was not on our property. That's correct. So one day there's a knock at the door from a neighbor who politely explained to us about property rules.
But then deeded you the tree, apparently, so all was well. And then after 2 years there, and this is sort of a glorious quote, because most people would say chance would be a fine thing in their own lives, but the guidance counselor said to your mother that Michael was being subjected to a lot of aggressive female attention. How terrible that must have been.
It was rough. It was rough.
But somebody had to do it.
Somebody had to do it. I think I was just one of those late bloomers, you know, growing up, so they all thought I was cute. I wasn't at full height yet, and was probably pretty harmless, but was having a little trouble as the hormones were raging, trying to balance my new social life with my academics, yeah.
But eventually you went on to Choate, and then on to University of California at Santa Barbara.
That's correct.
So that's when you came through as a late bloomer, as it were.
Well, sort of. It was really the first choice I made after going to these Eastern schools and thinking about going to an Ivy League school, and then, you know, just not happy and thinking I've got to make a change. What's the biggest change I could think about? And college counselors, I don't know how they are in England, but they're a little bit like travel agents. They have these brochures, they show you different schools, and this one brochure said Campus by the Sea. And there was no pictures of the buildings or the school or anything. It was simply a guy was walking down a beach carrying a surfboard, and there were two girls in two-piece bathing suits. And in 1963, back east, that was a phenomenon, yes. Two-piece bathing suit. So I think I said, I'm gonna go there.
Yeah.
As it turned out, it was the height of the University of California system, and it turned out to be a great experience.
And how long did you stay at the University of California?
Well, I was under the five-year plan. I was there for a year, and then they advised me that maybe it'd be better if I took a year off. I wasn't too serious about my academics, and then came back and finished up.
And so then how did you set out to start a career in films and theater? What was the first?
New York, went back to New York, started working and doing some classwork, auditioning.
By now you were sharing with Danny DeVito.
Almost, just about. Yeah. I had met Danny DeVito at the summer theater. He had come up, he was at the American Academy, which was the same school that both my mother and father had gone to. And we became friends there, and then soon after getting to New York, we got together as roommates. And we'd audition for off-Broadway and off-Broadway parts and shows, and then finally got a break in what they used to do was a CBS Playhouse. Yeah. And that brought me out to California.
Yeah. And what effect during the 60s did Vietnam have on you? I mean,
well,
you were
it
part
was,
of some protests or?
Yeah, I mean, we were, the whole experience of the University of California at Santa Barbara from 63 to 68, 69 was an incredible time, both with the war going on and culturally in terms of music and all of that. And some of our first theater efforts were what was called guerrilla theater, which was basically disrupting classes that was going on. A class would be going on, you would break into the classroom with a blank gun and squibs, and blood squibs and things, and reenact as if somebody was getting shot, and then quickly say, that's going on right now as you're here, and try to give a quick understanding of what was going on in Vietnam, and then rush out the door before the campus police got you.
You said there was more of a sense of community, you said, somewhere in the 60s that we've lost.
Well, I mean, I was a hippie. And I had found, and a lot of it I'm sure had to do with my own divorced family background, but really savored the sense of community, the sense of family. I spent a couple of years in an informal kind of group, and there was a spiritual link that was very, you know, non-economic. Money was not an issue at those particular times, that I remember, you know, very fondly. And I remember forming very close bonds with a lot of people that I still have.
So, and a lot of sex, drugs, and rock and roll at the same time.
A lot of sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
And some meditation, I read somewhere.
Yes, actually, I was involved with the same guru, Maharishi Maharaja Yoga, that was involved with the Beatles at another time. Not with him personally, but of his followers, and found meditation a very rewarding experience. Still try to do it from time to time.
And your mother, writing about Kirk, said success meant so much to him. It was a truly desperate thing, in a way. Did some of that rub off on you?
Well, I think, I mean, as he says, you know, we've always tried to do a picture together, a project together. And his story is a classic rags-to-riches story. He wrote The Ragman's Son. His father was a junk man, a rag man, and they started with nothing, and he built his whole career. For the next generation of people that don't have that affluent ladder to climb, how do you define yourself? Because you have the silver spoon in your mouth from the beginning, so on one side, success is assumed, yet so few of them have it. But I believe that I've inherited a lot of my father's stamina, a lot of my father's drive, absolutely.
A lot of your father's chin?
Yeah, not as much as his grandson.
Oh, really?
Oh, my God. He has it's the most amazing thing to see. He's got just a huge dimple, Dylan. Oh, really? Yeah, best thing, Kirk looked at this, I thought I was going to lose him. You know, he's just looked at this is what a sense of immortality, you know, a continuity of generations.
And in fact, your father, talking of working together, made that joke the other day that if two of you don't make a movie together soon, he's going to be too expensive for you, which I thought was a great line, in fact. Did you ever, or did your father ever, suffer from anti-Semitism in Hollywood? I mean, Lauren Bacall says very much so in her case.
I never quite knew where my father's rage came from. And I would say a lot of his roles were identified by an anger and a rage, which quite honestly was carried over for many years into his personal life. And for me, it was an eye-opener in reading his autobiography, The Ragman's Son, to understand that particularly as a white Russian Jew, somebody who might be mistaken because of his blonde wasp looks, that he heard things and was a part of things that made him really angry, yeah.
Yeah, and so that really had an effect.
But I think it played a strong effect with him.
Effect on him. And he said he couldn't, when he went to receive an award in Germany, and he said, I couldn't really work out what I was doing. This was quite recently, what I was doing as a Jew in Berlin. Do you know what I mean? The Holocaust obviously came back to him at that moment.
It did, but I also heard him say a couple of interesting things, because he met in particular, I forget her name, but a woman, as many Germans who risked their lives either through the Underground Railroad getting Jews out, or protecting him, and then he began to understand that this is part of the reason why he was back.
And in fact, he said on one occasion to your mother, you're basically happy, this is the difference between us, we come from such different backgrounds and viewpoints, you're basically happy unless something comes along which makes you unhappy, but I'm basically unhappy with moments of happiness. That's what Kirk said. Which are you, Michael?
I think I'm more like my mother. I'm inherently, I think, positive. I think there is truth to what he was saying. I like to think that he used to accuse my mother of, you know, being everything is fine, Dill. Like, you know, her name was Dill. Everything is lovely, Dill. Everything is always fine, which tends to be what I think is a lovely English trait. Sometimes it gets carried a little too far, but everything is fine. Everything is great. Carry on will be fine. He was a darker soul. I think I tend to be closer to my mother.
You said on one occasion that when you first started acting, and you censored yourself as an actor, because in terms of any gestures, limiting any gestures or whatever, that would be too reminiscent of your father and so on. Was that so? What sort of things?
Well, he had, you know, his rage and anger is a large part of acting, unfortunately. I don't know why we always love dramatic actors. We never give enough appreciation to comedy. But I would see myself sometimes doing drama and doing something and then thinking, my God, or somebody's saying, you're just like your father. So I sort of fell into doing these sort of sensitive young man roles. And then I took a look later historically and I saw that my father's career, his first 6 or 7 movies were all like a sensitive young man. It wasn't until The Champion in 1950, which he got nominated for an Academy Award, that kind of rage came out.
Those fat bellies with a big cigar are not gonna make a monkey out of me. I can beat him. You know I can beat him.
One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas will return. We return to One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas.
What did you regard as your first break, really, in terms of movies? Was it Hail Hero, or...?
No, Hail Hero was my first movie, and that was a disaster. But I did 3 or 4 pictures. I did the CBS Playhouse. I was under contract. I did about 3 movies, and then was falling back into doing episodic television. FBI, Medical Center, and then the Streets of San Francisco offer came to me.
Hold it!
The combination for me as a young actor of having the opportunity to know that there was 26 hours in that season and working with someone like Carl Malden really, really made a big difference in sort of giving me my discipline and my understanding.
And it was during that time that you were setting up One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, presumably.
That's correct. I had, during this lull and before Streets had come up, Kirk was selling Cuckoo's Nest. It was a project he had done on Broadway in 63 and spent a few years trying to get it set up and was unable to, and I took it over, and he was kind enough to let me take it over. I left the television series to go produce Cuckoo's Nest.
And you said once that Jack Nicholson might not have been the star. It could have been someone else, like Gene Hackman or...
Gene Hackman and Marlon Brando both turned the parts down at that time.
Just touch me once more. Just once more, huh? Just once more. Just touch me once more.
Play the game, Harding.
Just touch me once more, you fucking Jesus!
Open your mouth. Now bite down on it.
Here we go.
As wonderful as Jack is, at that time you would not think of him to play that kind of rough McMurphy kind of character. But we saw a movie called The Last Detail, directed by Hal Ashby, where Jack had played a kind of a Navy lifer, and saw him having the ability to play that role.
How are you, Nurse Ratched? I'm happy to be back.
We're happy to have you back, Randall.
Thank you.
Would you like to rest today, or would you like to join the group?
I'm proud to join the group, Mildred. They was giving me 10,000 watts a day, you know, and I'm hot to trot. Next woman takes me on is going to light up like a pinball machine and pay off in silver dollars.
And indeed, casting the Louise Fletcher part was not easy either, was it?
Well, it's interesting. Again, at that time, Nurse Ratched was a villain. And in the early spirit of the women's movement, it was not politically correct to play a villain. I mean, as male, as actors, we always wanted to play a good, meaty villain part. They were the best to play. So we had five actresses turn that role down before we were lucky and fortunate enough to get Louise Fletcher.
And you decided to do it in a real mental home and with real patience and so on. And sometimes the two got confused.
Well, we did. We spent a long time auditioning the actors, all the patients, to be in this ward. And we went up to the Oregon State Mental Hospital in Salem, Oregon, in which Ken Kesey, the author of the novel, actually, that was the actual hospital that he had written about in his book. And we had the superintendent of the hospital look at our cast and sort of give an outline, sort of a description of what are the ailments of some of the mental, you know, problems that some of these actors might have. And then they, in turn, would actually go and join real group therapy sessions. And a couple of them were getting pretty carried away, yeah. A couple of them got quite carried away. And I remember when Jack came to join us one day, he was a little late in terms of the rehearsal schedule. And we came in, we were rehearsing, and we broke at lunchtime. And Jack came in, and I saw him walk outside, he was holding his head. And I said, the producer, I said, what's wrong? What's going on? He said, who are these guys? They don't stop. I mean, this is lunchtime. Doesn't anybody take lunch around here? They don't break character. These guys just keep on going all the time. So it was a wonderful, magical world that was created, and, you know, obviously it was reflected in all the Academy Awards.
It was really, the mental hospital was, in a sense, a reasonable metaphor for American
society.
Life,
yeah.
American society.
Yeah. Yeah, it was. I think that was the popularity of the book, particularly of my generation, yeah. in college and everything, was what they called the combine, and it was the combine, the mental hospital, and the rules and regulations was what the reflection of what society was, or perceived.
Victims
to.
Of a matriarchy, Jack says at one point.
Mm-hmm. Well, he has some good lines about women. One of them I always remembered was, women, he said, they're smarter than we are, but they don't play fair.
One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas will return. We return to One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas.
Then your next major project in 79 was not only producing but co-starring in The China Syndrome. Now, was that triggered off by a script submission or by your concern about the issue?
It was a script submission, and I just thought, what a great monster movie this makes.
What the hell's...
You know, this incredible machine with this power. And then as I started working on the script, I became more and more immersed in the subject matter. And at the same time, Jane Fonda was at the same studio developing the Karen Silkwood story. And so they decided to kind of join us together in working on this. And so we sort of changed a couple of parts for Jane, that she could play one of the roles. And it was out of the kind of the research and due diligence on it that I became aware of the subject matter. And then it was the most prophetic thing that has ever happened to me, because at the time of the opening of the picture, we were under heavy, heavy criticism from a lot of the large industrial companies in the United States involved with development of nuclear power about being irresponsible, you know, Hollywood filmmaker types. And it was 3 weeks after the picture opened that Three Mile Island happened in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And in the China Syndrome, one of the ways that we describe what a China Syndrome is that it would melt down an area the size of Pennsylvania. And it was an epiphany for me. It really was. I felt it was the closest to a religious experience, and has really was the beginning for me of my quest and pursuit for the elimination of nuclear weapons and ultimately elimination of nuclear power
at the moment,
in my lifetime.
Yeah. At the moment, nuclear power seems to be making something of a comeback, doesn't it?
It is. It seems to be making a comeback in terms of because of drillings and all of that, but it's been cyclical like that every 20 years or so, depending on who's in power. And you and I were talking earlier about at least some of my concerns about our U.S. president administration and the relatively cavalier kind of attitude that we seem to be taking, at least not talking with a lot of our neighbors and our partners on this very little tiny planet that we're on.
And so you're still as concerned about nuclear power today as you were then?
Well, yeah, more so. Yeah. I mean, more so, just in terms of its lifespan, its life expectancy, its half-life, and how long it's a poison that is unbelievable. And I think for a lot of people who worked in the discovery and development of the atomic bomb, this was their answer, that we could use this as a power source. And I know there's been debate in your own country. So this is a time that makes me concerned, yeah.
And in fact, in the film, the message, as it were, of the film, or the underlying seriousness of the film, you've balanced very well with the excitement of the plot. And you said on one occasion, you get in a hell of a lot of trouble if you start preaching before you start moving people.
Well, you have to. I mean, I think you have to. You know, my job is a storyteller, is a filmmaker. I always like to have a movie which has a certain amount of food for thought, but you really can't accomplish that unless you've done your first role, which is dramatically make something rewarding for staying there for 2 hours.
So, at that point in the proceedings, of your life, that you had the world at your feet at that point after the China Syndrome, and then a serious skiing accident intervenes for 3 years. What exactly happened?
Well, I was still able to get Romancing the Stone in before that, but I had I severed, it's called the meniscus, the anterior cruciate, and the patella. And it was a year, really. I was in a cast for about 10 months. Rehabilitation took another 6 or 7 months, and it's never been quite the same. But you know, just one of those classic, not skiing all season. It was being springtime, soft snow. Meeting a friend who used to ski a lot better than, who was also up trying to keep up with him, and late in the day, all these classic stupid things you shouldn't be doing. Mm.
And I presume it cured you of skiing again?
No, I ski all the time. I just make sure that my left binding's a little lightly adjusted, so I'd rather have to worry about losing my ski than blowing out my knee again, but it hasn't given me too much trouble.
But you've always been one to take risks, haven't you?
I think so. I used to do a lot of silly things when I was a kid in terms of high diving and all of that, and I think it's interesting as we're learning and discovering about genes and risk-taking now, they discover, is a genetic makeup. People who like to take risks of different kinds.
But I bet when Dylan starts taking risks, then he'll feel quite differently about it.
I feel a lot better. I'm sure he'll be much more like his mother.
Then Romancing the Stone, which was a huge success. In general, do you know in advance which of your films are going to be hits and which are not? Or is it a
No, I haven't, because most of my history of producing the films, and even the ones I've acted in, nobody wanted to make. I mean, starting with Cuckoo's Nest, which was turned down by all the studios, The China Syndrome was not a subject matter anybody wanted to make. Romancing the Stone, this was before Raiders of the Lost Ark, we were developing it. You could not juggle action, adventure, and romance and comedy in the same picture. You couldn't keep those three balls in the air. That's what you were told. So I've just was lucky enough early in my career to have success, which allowed me to trust my instincts.
And in fact, you've noted more recently that the independents seem to be doing more of the major successful pictures than the studios.
It certainly appears that way. It's a whole other subject, but we really, in our industry, it's changed dramatically over the last, you know, 5 or 6 or 7 years. We were somewhat of a cottage industry with as big as Hollywood was supposed to be. It was still like individual studios. And over the last few years, these individual motion picture studios have become parts of very huge conglomerates of either Japanese, Australian, French, Canadian companies, American companies too, in which motion pictures is one small part of this huge conglomerate of cable and television, and are being treated in a much more formal kind of corporate way in terms of quarterly earnings. You're getting much more sequels being made, much more effort to reach the lowest common denominator. And I think we'll be seeing some more chances being taken, and that's why I do see an upsurge of independent filmmaking coming on, or at least studios really respecting and allowing independents to get their voice heard. Because each year, this year, for instance, with the Academy Awards, there was a proportionally large number of independent films that were represented.
And on Romancing the Stone, what was the saga of a 60-foot crane and Danny DeVito and a poster for Romancing the Stone?
There was a show that was sort of like a candid camera or one of those types.
Now, here's our victim, Danny DeVito.
And we worked out we thought it was a clever marketing idea, and I told Danny, I said, look, Danny, we've got a great idea. I said, we're working on a poster, okay? We just got to put you up on this crane.
They're going to put you in a rig, and what they're going to do to match, they're going to hang you up. Okay. Then we'll put you in with us on the rope.
Like
so that's
basically
that's
it.
And it won't be tall. It won't be high.
Okay.
Don't worry.
At one point, the crane will swing him over a balcony, where we will have an actress planted that's in on the joke.
Take him out.
And so we set it all up, but it was all a hoax.
Why are you okay, Tom?
So and they had these hidden cameras. You know, he thought it was like a still shot. We picked them all up down the beach on this crane, and he kept looking at me. It was funnier than hell.
It's clear that Danny's really a good sport.
And then years later, I did this picture, The War of the Roses, which was with Kathleen and Danny directed as well. It was in it. And at the end of the War of the Roses, we end up on top of the chandelier. And I'll never forget, we got ready one day to start this whole sequence. It was a little dangerous, about 60 feet up, and we were hooked up, and we got all ready, and he said, okay, is everybody all right? You all right? He said, yeah, all right, you're all set? Good. He said, okay, that's lunch. He said, and he called the crew, he said, I've been wanting to do this to you for I don't know how long, all right? You took me down there in Mexico with the mud, you hung me up that crane, and now you can sit up there.
Yeah. Perfect. Poetic justice.
It was poetic justice.
Poetic justice.
One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas will return. We return to One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas.
Moving along the career things, it was the fall of 87, wasn't it, that Fatal Attraction
right.
hit a waiting world. And you said on one occasion about actually making that film that it was almost like a political decision to decide to actually make it in the first place.
Well, there wasn't. It was difficult to who to root for, in that picture. You know, to play an adulterer, but it was such a great concept, because it was a philanderer's worst nightmare.
And in fact, that was one of the key things, wasn't it? That your character, although having cheated on an absolutely wonderful wife, does get some sympathy. Was that most of all in the way you played it, or most of the way, all in the way you wrote it?
Well, we don't know. We were always surprised. I mean, and we did. We set this up. I said, let's make this have a Ann Archer, this beautiful woman as your wife, to make it even tougher. Say, why would you do something as stupid as this? But you know what? We've all done stupid things in our lives. Maybe it's not committing adultery, maybe it's something else, but you make one mistake, you know, and this is an example of paying the price.
You have to be discreet.
Oh, God, yeah.
Are you?
Yeah, my what?
Discreet.
So when we saw the first test screenings, there was a scene where I go back to my house and I get in the bed and rustle up the sheets to make it look like I had slept there that night. And the audience sort of laughed. I can't believe this. They're gonna forgive me already. You know, they're gonna forgive us. But I think what happened is that once the Glenn Close character went after the family unit, right, that was when, you know, the gloves come off, so to speak, and the audience's general sympathy were now for the family as a unit.
Most of all, is it about obsession, too, do you think, as a film, or it is just about a man who makes a mistake?
Well, it's certainly about, it was certainly on the woman's part, her obsession, and Glenn Close's role, Alex, the obsession that she had. But I think it's, I've always been fascinated, Dave, with morality tales. You know, I don't see my dad's generation in the movies, sort of was before television, where you had white knights and black heroes. It was much more black and white. And then really with the advent of television and more character things, I see things more in a gray area. I think people are trying to do the best that they can. But there are struggles, and so I'm always interested in those characters that either made a mistake and is trying to redeem it, or to not make a mistake.
And in your morality tales, do the people who usually end up getting their comeuppance, I'm trying to think?
Yeah, it's usually there's a price to be paid.
Very powerful film, wasn't it?
It was. We were really, really proud of it. It was a movie that was very disturbing in a lot of areas. I remember coming over to Europe and talking, remember, the French press. The French press, of course, said, well, you know, we have mistresses. This is nothing. What is this about? And it was a tremendous hit in France. It was every French wife dragged their, you know, husband down to that theater to see
this,
that movie.
This could happen to
you.
This
could happen to you. Yes.
Then we soon come to Wall Street. And also in 1987, current biography saluted, quote, your uncanny knack for choosing projects that reflect changing trends and public concerns. which, when you think about the ones we've been talking about, China Syndrome, Fatal Attraction again, and then Wall Street, you do seem to have that knack.
I like current events. I'm a big newspaper reader. I read about 3 newspapers a day. Unfortunately, never read enough books. I find one of the bad parts about being a producer is you end up reading so many bad screenplays that your attention span is much more limited to magazines and short articles. But I guess that has a lot to do with it, just sort of being aware of what's going on in the world at any one time.
And America, you were Gordon Gekko, memorably, of course.
America has become a second-rate power. The point is, ladies and gentlemen, that greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works. Greed clarifies, cuts through, and captures the essence of the evolutionary spirit. Greed, in all of its forms, greed for life, for money, for love, knowledge, has marked the upward surge of mankind, and greed, you mark my words, will not only save Teldar Paper, but that other malfunctioning corporation called the USA. Thank you very much.
Can greed ever be good?
I think you pay a price for it, as the character did in that picture. But David, if I tell you the number of investment bankers over the years that come up to me drunk at some restaurant saying, you know, you're the guy that got me into my business, greed is good, you know, yeah. And I'm looking at you, I was the bad guy, you know, I was supposed to be the villain. But there was something about that character and villainry in general, which allows people when they see a movie, you know, to project into that kind of character.
And then after War of the Roses, we move on quite soon to Basic Instinct, which was another landmark, 1993. You've never done a sequel.
No, I took my pants off once is enough.
A memorable moment for old and young alike. A darkly phobic lust story. Grade A pulp fiction. What's the best definition for Basic Instinct?
Well, I call it a slam dance. I remember we were at that particular time, it appeared to be a very politically correct time in our country. And for some reason, I had this desire to do something that was blatantly nasty and on the edge and to try in a couple things. And we succeeded at it.
It's nice.
You like playing games, don't you?
I have a degree in psychology. It goes with the turf. Games are fun.
What about boxing? That's a game. Is that fun, too?
I don't think that's relevant to this inquiry.
Boxing was fun till Manny died.
How'd you feel when he died?
I loved him. It hurt.
How'd you feel when I told you Johnny Boz had died?
I felt like someone had read my book and was playing a game.
But it didn't hurt.
No.
It was a huge success, wasn't
Big
it?
Big success, yeah.
And in fact, it featured one of the things you quite like to confound political correctness whenever you can, don't you?
I do. I like to kind of ruffle a few feathers. I enjoy the debate. After that picture, I was, you know, because of the success of Fatal Attraction, it was becoming sort of like my sex films. But sex is hard to do in cinema. You know, everybody tries it. But when you think about it, when you see movies and all the different kind of actions and everything else, one of the few things that an audience really understands is sex. I mean, that they can relate to, and then that makes it that much more difficult to pull off. Not that many members of the audience have been involved in gunfires or this or that, and that's a much more easier device to dramatically pull off. But But, you know, sex scenes, everybody's a judge.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, Orson Welles said to me once in an interview, he said, the two most difficult things to do in a movie is the act of love and the act of prayer, because neither are really intended as spectator sports. Which
it's
I
true.
Thought was a neat definition.
Yeah, it's a very good point. Yeah.
About that time, of course, talking of sex, there was all those stories, people were very envious reading that you'd gone into a clinic because of your sex addiction. Was that why you went in?
No, that was a very clever story that some good Fleet Street tabloid editor
came. It was dear old Fleet Street in England.
It was. They started, I think, rather than another boring story of somebody going to rehab for alcohol abuse, with the success of Fatal Attraction, it made for a much more interesting story. That was the first people heard about sex addiction.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, it has...
Most people want to get it.
I know, I said. Right. And it's stuck around a long time. And I mean, they find clever ways to say the quote, self-confessed. I don't know what I ever said. But they've got other ways of saying it all.
Self-confessed, self-styled.
Yes, self-styled.
Another word. They'd...
But no, that was, I would like to have understood what sex addiction is.
Yeah, absolutely. What did you go in for, just for...
Alcohol abuse, yeah. I don't know whether it was my marital state. I had recently, at that time, lost my stepfather, William Darrod, who I was very, very close to. I basically grew up with him, and my father recognized him as my surrogate dad. He was really an extraordinary guy, and he died unexpectedly and at a young age. There was some cancer issues with my mother at that time. And I think it was just an overall cumulative effect and working too hard and burning the candle at both ends. And I found it a very, very rewarding experience, particularly what happens for people who get into the public eye. It's hard to find an environment that is safe and allows you some chances to explore issues and areas. And was very angry, and I think is, you know, really was the beginning of, you know, somewhat of a rage about tabloid journalism, and at what point do you go over the line in terms of invading the privacy of somebody who's a celebrity?
In that sense, celebrity for you is different to what it was for a lot of Kirk's career.
Kirk didn't have to contend
with
that. There were rules, and, you know, with Hedda Hopper, Luella Parsons, and all your big gossip, so-called Hollywood writers, you did not get into personal issues. Just as for pretty much even with politicians, there were things that were just not discussed.
One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas will return. We return to One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas.
If you don't live up to the deal you just made, come New Hampshire, we're going to go shopping for a new candidate.
You can't do that, Sydney.
With all due respect, Mr. President, who's going to stop me?
Well, if you go through that door, the United States Secret Service. That's my private office.
Ah.
You have to go out that door.
When The American President came along as a film, that was a real change of pace, as I say.
Comedy, romantic comedy. Also, you just somehow don't imagine that you could be old enough to play the president.
Yeah, yeah.
But you are.
Do you do this often, sir?
Well, this is actually only our second state dinner. The first one was for the Emperor of Japan. who died shortly after, so we stopped having them for a while just in case.
Now, I meant, do you go out on that? Do you often?
Do I date a lot?
Yeah.
No, how about you?
Me? Well, lately I seem to be going out on a lot of first dates.
Well, then you're experienced at this.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you can ask me anything.
Well, how are we doing so far?
It's hard to say at this point. So far, it's just your typical first date stuff.
Damn, and I want to be different from the other guys.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
Oh, by the way,
accompanied by
nice shoes.
But it hadn't really been since maybe Romancing the Stone that I'd done anything, you know, comedic. And it was a wonderful script. Rob Reiner, fantastic director, Annette Bening. It was a lovely experience from top to bottom. It's one of those pictures. I don't normally see my movies after they've done, maybe once in screenings, but I'm not. But that's one I enjoy seeing from time to time.
But you don't usually.
No, I don't go to movies. I'm afraid to say I love making movies. I love the whole process, either producing or acting, working on them. But in my spare time, I really have to make an effort, sort of end of year, to see films. I'm a sports junkie.
Look at this shot. This guy is unbelievable. He's a machine. Don't stand there like the alpha male that we all know you are these days, babe. Okay? Okay. Don't be strutting. Okay?
I'm afraid. I love all forms of sports. Because movies you can guess the endings. You know, sporting events, you never know what's going to happen. So I like news, sports, and nature shows.
And in terms of the American president, what's the secret to looking presidential, did you decide?
Having the right amount of shoulder padding. Yeah. What you look and realize is that it's a triangle. It really is, because everything is shot from here. So they spend a lot of efforts professionally as well in movies is to kind of create that triangle. So the shoulder pads are generally a little oversized, and stick out, no soft sloping shoulders.
That's the trick.
That's part of it.
And presumably the other thing, it's nice having people calling you Mr. President all day.
All day long.
A few weeks.
Yeah, I got used to that, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I was a little impossible for a while when I came home.
Now, in recent days, the year 2000, for instance, was a landmark year for you with two major films, Wonder Boys and Traffic.
Right. It was a wonderfully rewarding year. Wonder Boys is a film which I loved. Did not do well in the box office. It was a big surprise to me. It was a great screenplay, a lot of good performances, well directed. And those are the kind of ones that shake you up, you know, because you think this seems to have everything, but couldn't find its audience. Traffic, on the other hand, has been a much bigger commercial success. It was always a really good film. It was received very well critically, but had no idea it was going to be as commercially successful as it was.
No, it did better than you expected because the plot was quite complex and so on.
It was.
But it really had an impact on people about being anti-drugs, actually.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, drugs are one of those sort of taboo subjects in families that have touched everyone, but, you know, everybody has some member of a family or knows someone who's been affected to some degree, but they don't want to talk about it. I think for parents, somehow it's a sign of failure as a parent if your child has pursued drugs. And so it's unfortunate because there are so many self-help programs and so much that can be done if people are willing to talk a little more about it. But it's one of those subjects that somehow is a reflection on their upbringing.
Lord knows I tried every drug there was known to...
I don't want to hear about that. You experimented when you were in college.
Should we take the quotes off experiment and call it what it was?
This is different.
Why?
Because she's 16 years old.
I just think she needs to find out for herself, on her own. We have to allow her room to
Oh,
to
you want to give
out.
Her room? I think she can OD like that other kid? Caroline, open this door immediately.
Open the goddamn door!
1 minute! If there is a war on drugs, then many of our family members are the enemy. I don't know how you wage war on your own family.
There's a student, high school student, isn't it, in the film, says, for someone my age, it's a lot easier to get drugs than it is to get alcohol.
That's true. I mean, that's a fact. To buy alcohol, which is, you know, supposedly governed, you know, you have to show an ID and all of that to buy drugs. You don't have to show anything except money.
Do you think we will legalize cannabis, marijuana in the near future?
I don't know if we will in the near future, but I don't see how cannabis can be grouped together with some of the other drugs that it is now, and I don't think it makes a lot of sense. I mean, historically, the record of overdoses of cannabis is possibly just off the chart, 0.001% versus death by alcohol, cigarettes obviously leading them. Drugs in general are taboo, but play a much smaller part in terms of actual deaths as opposed to alcohol or cigarettes.
And coming on to the year 2001, there was one night at McCool's, and coming up, don't say a word. Now, one night at McCool's, did you enjoy that? That was a smaller role.
It was a small picture for my production.
You were trying to look like Johnny Cash, it said, someone said.
Well, I've been enjoying, you know, sort of with Wonder Boys, and at this point in my career, David, you know, stretching it and having some fun as an actor and doing more kind of character roles. I'm trying just to do different things and have some fun.
And what is Don't Say a Word?
Don't Say a Word is a psychological thriller involving a well-to-do New York professional family. I'm a psychiatrist whose daughter's kidnapped because of a plot. They want a patient of mine to give some information, and it's a thriller directed by Gary Fleeter, did a movie called Kiss the Girls that they just had a sequel made with Along Came a Spider. It was the sequel to Kiss the Girls.
And I read somewhere that you've got about 12 scripts that are ready to go. Is that true?
Well, I wish they were all ready to go. They're in development, which is actually a lot less than I used to have. It's one of those things, be careful what you wish for, it may come true. And with my production success, I sort of got a bigger and bigger production company, and then finally was beginning to lose the joy of producing as well as acting, so I simplified it a lot. But I have been working the last couple of years and have about 12 projects. 3 or 4 of them, I think, are pretty close to going. Yeah.
And talking of joy, one at least of them is for you and Catherine, is it?
Well, we're doing one. That's not actually one of my productions, but yeah, Catherine and I are going to do a kind of a romantic adventure comedy called Smoke and Mirrors. It's based upon Robert Houdin, who was the original French magician who Houdini based his whole character on. And it's a kind of a romp that we're going to probably do the end of this year in Morocco and Spain, probably.
One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas. We'll return. return to One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas.
How different are the stars you remember of your father's generation and the stars you see today?
Well, there was a larger-than-life quality, I think, in my father's generation. I just think that there was almost a theatrical presentation. As I said, television really, even up until like the late 50s, there's only like one or two television stations. Cable is a whole new phenomenon. So we really counted, my father's in 85 movies. He used to do four a year. So there was a larger-than-life quality, which I think has drastically changed with television, which has made a whole style of a much more kind of a reality style than there was before. I also think that because of access to transportation, communications, there's not the Hollywood family that there was back then, the closeness that people can live all over the world now and then report to work wherever it might be.
At the same time also, I cannot imagine you in the studio system. You would have been rebelling all the time, wouldn't you?
That was a difficult time, and as you know, my father is was the first actors to set up his own independent production company and not be under contract.
Do you think Hollywood provoke some of the violence in our society, or merely reflect?
I think it depends upon the situation. I think that we have gotten very vassal at creating violent situations in films because it's easy to do, to make exciting. I think that the same violent Hollywood movie that is in the States, that is supposedly the motivation for all these crimes, is also shown in Canada, or it's shown in Britain, or it's shown in Japan, but there is no reaction because there are no guns. And so my personal feeling, and I've been feel very strongly about this issue too, is that we have an inordinate amount of handguns in particular in our country. And so those same violent movies are shown in other countries without the same result. And I think in large part it has to do because they don't have any weapons, they don't have guns.
We were talking earlier on about dating when teenagers and so on. You said things that would suggest that you think men are having a much more difficult time with their roles in society today than perhaps you did in Westport, Connecticut in those days.
Well, I mean, this one always gets me in so much trouble. This is an issue that always, because there's a lot of wonderful and important things that came out of the women's movement, and certainly women have had an opportunity to develop careers. And I think there's a lot of men who have gotten mixed signals and are at a loss because on one side they're competing sometimes, and on the other side they're still trying to fulfill their male roles. But I think there's a confusion that's happened, and some of my pictures sort of dealt with that for a while. I think it is past now, and I think the wave, I think we've gotten used, unfortunately, to too much to two-income households, and particularly in our country, along with this issue of what's happening with our kids, is the fact that nobody's home. I mean, there is nobody's home. When I graduated from college, a woman or a man could graduate in homemaking. That is perceived now as almost being sacrilegious. But the art, obviously the art and joy of making a home is an incredible and nurturing entity, which I do think has been lost under the two-income families. And, you've got a lot of what we call lock-key kids in the States, which are basically kids that have a key around their necks that come home and let themselves into their own apartments at pretty young ages. I'm not saying I know the answer to this, But I do think that a lot of women are reevaluating after having been out in the workplace and the workforce and said, wait a minute, I'm not missing anything. If I can afford it, or if I can, that I can take pride in nurturing and making a home, and that's something to be proud of.
I remember in the early days of Women's Lib, one of the leaders of Women's Lib was on the program in New York and said that women should be paid, wives should be paid for doing the housework. And I had a letter from a man in Philadelphia which said, "Dear David, I am quite prepared to pay my wife for doing the housework as long as she promises only to come in on Thursdays." One other issue that not reflected in that, but is an issue that crops up all the time is, and we've touched on it, which is the dumbing down or otherwise of America. Do you feel there's been dumbing down in politics, in movies, in television?
Yeah, I sometimes feel like it's the 1950s and we got hula hoops on. And I mean, I understand it. I'm thinking about back at Eisenhower, we have no major conflict for a long period. We have the U.S. now the wealthiest country in the history of civilization, a whole couple of generations that know nothing about war, and it's an incredibly fortunate time. But it does appear, and this is where I think our particular culture and media has been letting us down, and it does seem that the lowest common denominator is what gets one's attention.
One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas will return. We return to One-on-One with David Frost, Michael Douglas.
This is a great setting here. Michael, do tell us about it.
Well, this is called Costa Nord, the North Coast, and we're in the town of Valdemosa, which is a beautiful town, Valley of the Moors, and this was a whole Moorish area. And in the 20 years that I've spent, you know, here in Mallorca, I've been doing a lot of homework about the North Coast, which is where Sestak, our house, is, and this mountain range, the Serra Tramuntana. And a lot of people only know Mallorca in terms of the tourist beaches over around Palma, which are so popular. But I decided to put a cultural center together and have built this cultural center to kind of inform and educate people about the North Coast of Mallorca. And we have a theater here that I've shot a 15-minute film that plays around the clock in about six different languages, which sort of gives a history of the North Coast.
The Costa Nord is like nowhere else in Mallorca. Over the centuries, poets and painters, mystics and musicians, philosophers and free spirits have all come here, lured by the majesty and the mystery of its sea and its mountains.
There is a thread of mystery and magic that runs through this part of the island. The medieval mystics and hermits who sought wisdom in its mountains. The writers who sensed the presence of its ancient gods. The painters who marveled at its majestic landscapes. And the Austrian Archduke who rejoiced in its unspoiled glories. They all fell under the spell of the Costa Nord of Mallorca. 20 years ago, I came to this island, and I, too, fell under that spell, a spell that time and change cannot break.
In terms of using your fame and so on like that, have you ever been tempted, maybe only momentarily, like Arnold Schwarzenegger was, like Warren Beatty was, but have you ever been tempted to run for office?
Well, they've approached me a couple of times. The most recent was as governor of California. And I remember a coterie of congressmen met with me, and they said, you know, we've hired a study. We've put a big study together, and the study tells us that the best opportunity as Democrats that we have to win back the governorship is to find, number one, somebody that is well known, and number two, who could finance his own campaign. And I said, how much did you pay for this study? I said, because this is what you learn after the study, to find somebody who's well known and who can also spend all of his own money on his campaign. I said, I hope that was not a very expensive study that you did.
And somebody, who was it who said, if you have half a mind to go into politics, that's all you need.
That's right. That's a good point.
But has religion been important to you in your life or not?
Well, that's a good question, David. My father is Jewish. My mother is the Church of England, Episcopalian. My father rediscovered his Judeo background, his Judeo doctrine, after he had a helicopter crash when he was 70 years old, and they hit an airplane, and a 18-year-old student pilot and his instructor were killed instantly. And I think he really began to question why he was still alive and they weren't. So, and I've watched what religion has done for my father and his quest in the last 15 years. And he's a changed man, spiritually, a sense of humor. But my biggest problem is that I keep looking around the world, and the most barbaric acts that I see seem to be in the name of religions. So I'm having a difficult time sometimes equating with what religion is supposed to be doing, and yet this terrible conflict that I see between religions around the world.
Now, it was in 1998, wasn't it, that a turning point in your life happened in Deauville, wasn't it?
That's right.
How did you first meet Catherine?
Well, I met Catherine, like a lot of people, I guess, saw the movie Zorro.
No bad?
No bad at all.
And I remember looking, saying, who is that? I'm a big fan of Julie Christie. I think when she first came on, and that's how I felt when I saw Catherine. I said, wow. And I was happily single, you know, my divorce was final, and I was having a pretty good time. And I was in the Deauville Film Festival promoting A Perfect Murder. And I looked at the schedule, and each night's a different movie, and I saw the schedule at Zorro was being previewed the night after our film was there. So I said, well, you know, I asked somebody if they could find out if Catherine Zeta-Jones was coming to promote the film, and if she was coming alone, and if it was possible I could have a drink and maybe dinner with her. And the word got back, well, you're lucky, she is coming, she's coming alone. We'll see about dinner, but certainly have a drink. And so that was that, and I went and had a drink, and...
Was it love at first sight?
Well, I think we kind of go past that point, but what I was so impressed with was, as physically beautiful as Catherine is, there was no self-consciousness about it. She had a great sense of humor and an unpretentious quality that made it her very, very attractive. And I think then in the first evening we found out that we shared the same birthday.
September the 25th.
September the 25th. And it is true, sometime later that evening, after a few celebrations, I did speak about, I want to father your children.
Good. You
So jumped
that was,
right in
that's
on
pretty
that.
Much
that was that was either right. And she, I think her line was, but she was there only that night. She had to get up early, and she was shooting Entrapment with Sean Connery and had to go off. I think her last line to me was something to the effect, well, you know, I've heard a lot about you, Michael, and I've seen a lot about you, and it's nice to know it's all true. Good night, you know. So I said, okay, that takes care of that. But we were able to have sort of a long-distance relationship. We were both working in telephone conversations and kind of got together that Christmas of 98 back in L.A. at my mother's house. And then the following year, around June, finally, I talked her into coming over here to Spain, to Sestaca, and that was it.
And where did you propose, in Spain?
No, I proposed in Aspen, Colorado, on New Year's Eve of the millennium.
Oh,
sick as a dog, both of us were. But I said, this is too good to be, you know, to miss. So I proposed and threw a lot of coughs and sniffles and all that.
And of course, now Dylan is the star resident of your home.
He is.
As we speak, he's 9 months old.
9 months old, and he's given us a tremendous amount of joy and happiness. And life's going on. I think neither one of us was quite aware, quite ready for this kind of press brouhaha publicity that happens when two people get together. It's a weird phenomenon of one and one makes like six. The press are much so curious, I guess, when two people have some kind of celebrity and come together, and neither of us was quite ready for that, but we've adjusted.
Were you present when Dylan was born?
I was. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I was right there. It's one of the most magical feelings of the world. Particularly, something very unique about a boy coming out of your wife, the mother. And it's fantastic.
Was the experience so special that you're going to repeat it?
Yeah. Well, we're, our only debate is Catherine wants three kids, and I'd be happy with one other. And it's against reflection. She has two brothers. There's three in her family, and there's only two in mine. So I think that's probably where it comes from. But we'll see. We'll go for the second one. We'll see where everybody's feeling about the third.
And would you like Dylan to be an actor, or would you hope not?
I wish, you know, happiness on my children, both Cameron, who's 22, who's a DJ, very successful spinner in New York, who has sometimes talks about overtures about acting, but you just want them to establish their own identity, I think, and you know that, having some sense from growing up with my father, how much of a shadow it does put over your own life, that they find a way to get the sense of their own identity and happiness.
Do you ever wonder what the world will be like when he's 21? I mean, it's going to be very different. That we can be sure of.
Well, I estimate he'll probably be living to over 100, 105, 110. His children, my grandchildren, will be living probably an average age of 120. It's going so quickly now.
You said once, half of me is extremely lazy, the other half pushes relentlessly. Do you balance those two in your life, do you think?
Well, I do. I don't have the control of it. When I'm working, it's all consuming, and I've been fortunate enough to always try to limit, you know, what I'm doing to things that I really want to do rather than just for biz. Making films requires a long time. It takes a lot of tenacity. And so therefore, it better be something you really are in love with.
Yeah.
And I am unrelenting. And then when I fall off or when I'm done, I kick back.
And
couch potato.
And you're not really concerned, I sense, about the thought of growing old. As they say, it's better than the alternative, but
it's right. Yeah. it's a lot in the eye of the beholder. I mean, that's one of the lovely things about having a younger wife.
Yes.
It's one of the joys about having, you know,
young children
starting up with. There's a limitation of roles that comes into effect. But saying that, you know, my father's 85 years old and he's sending me scripts for us to do. This is a career that we can do for a really long time.
We're still looking for our picture.
They say that a son should follow in his father's footsteps, but I am a father who's trying to follow in my son's footsteps.
You're going to be a grandfather again soon, right?
I know what you're going to say. If you don't marry her, I will, right?
Right now, again, the balance between my family and my professional work and the things that I'd like to do with the United Nations, I feel, you know, very kind of well-balanced and rewarding and do not think about getting old.
And in fact, the very point about being able to act at 70 and 85, when we were talking about being a sports star, one of the advantages of being in our business rather than a sports star, you'd be over the hill at 35.
No, it's true. Yeah. It's one of the issues I've talked with a lot of my friends in sports. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that is a short life.
It's a very short span.
Someone described you rather touchingly as the John Wayne of the gender movies. That's rather good.
I haven't heard that one. I don't know. I mean, John Wayne, who I worked with, was a larger-than-life figure, and I tend to be attracted to roles that are everyman roles. I tend to represent everyman, and people could say, "Gee, that could be me." And so it lacks some of the dynamics on one side. But on the other, I seem to, in terms of the feedback I get, people seem to identify much more.
Your father was asked what he'd like his epitaph to be, and he said, quote, "I tried," end quote. Very good epitaph. Do you have a thought about how you'd like to be remembered in that sense?
I try not to think about this too much, David.
Well, we're looking way into the future here. Yes, way.
No, exactly. I think it would have to something along the quality of life, in terms of how one lives one's life, but the quality of how one lives a life and giving it your best shot. I haven't got it down as distinctly as Kirk has, but he's a little closer than I am.
One-on-one with David Frost, Michael Douglas, will return.